Hello, so in this lecture I'm going to teach you about the kinetic theory of gases. So this is how I've organized my lecture. I'll start with an introduction, then I'll talk about the assumptions of kinetic theory of gases, then I'll derive some important results based on by using those assumptions, then finally I'll solve two IIT JEE problems as practice. Okay, so then let's get started with the introduction. So I feel that this kinetic theory of gases is an extremely fascinating theory. Now why do I say that it is so fascinating? It's because you see gases all around us, right? We breathe, we hear, we talk, we digest the food, and even fart because of gases. And all the behavior of these gases can be explained using a very simple law called the ideal gas law. And you must already be knowing what that law is. It's that PV equal to nRT. And this law was derived experimentally. So it's an empirical law. Just by observing the behavior of gases, one can arrive at this very simple law. And all real gases obey this law under some conditions, that is of low pressure and low density. So now our question is it possible to derive this ideal gas law theoretically, that is just starting with some assumptions about how gases behave? Can we arrive this ideal gas law? So when we ask such questions, it reminds me of Einstein, because he just, with the help of a pen and paper, he derived very great truths about this nature, which changed the way the world looks at nature. He produced the special theory of relativity, general theory of relativity, all sitting at his desk. So when we do the derivation related to this kinetic theory of gases, we get a chance to experience that same thrill which Einstein would have experienced. So the goal of this lecture is can we come up with a derivation which will relate the microscopic quantities with the macroscopic quantities? What do I mean by that? See, microscopic quantities are the variables which we use to describe behavior at microscopic levels, like at the atomic level. So we know that the gases are made of atoms and molecules. So whatever behavior of gases we experience at the macroscopic level, that is at the level we can feel, for example, we can feel the pressure exerted by gases, we can see the volume of the gases increase when we fill a balloon with air. So volume, pressure, and we can feel the temperature of the gas if we keep heating it. So volume, pressure, and temperature are the macroscopic variables which describe the behavior of gases. And the microscopic quantities which describe the behavior of gases will be the velocity, the momentum, the mass of the gas molecules. So can we arrive at this at an expression for the pressure exerted by the gas based on, say, its velocity and mass of the gas molecules? So U is what we will use to denote the velocity of a gas molecule, and pressure, temperature are the macroscopic variables. So can we find a relation between U and temperature or pressure? So that is our goal of this lecture. Okay, so now what are the assumptions of kinetic theory? Now any theory which we start, it will start with some assumptions. Okay, so assuming that, so starting with those assumptions, we will build our model to describe nature within certain constraints. So we have four assumptions in this kinetic theory. So the first assumption is that the gas molecules are all point particles, that is they occupy zero volume. So this is just to simplify our calculations. See, the gas molecules, they are so small compared to the separation between the molecules, so we can easily make this approximation that the gas molecules are point particles. Then we make the next assumption we make is about the pressure exerted by the gas molecules. We assume that the pressure is caused by the collision of the gas molecules with the walls of the container. See here, you can see the molecules moving about inside the container. Now each time one of these molecules collides with the wall of the container, it will exert a force. So the sum of all these forces exerted by the collisions with the wall will produce the pressure when that total force is divided by the area of the surface of the wall. So this is the assumption we are going to make to derive at the pressure exerted by the gases. We will be finding out the total force exerted by the gas molecules when they hit each side of the wall, each wall of the container. Okay. Then the third assumption is that all the collisions between the gas molecules are perfectly elastic. By that I mean that when the collisions between the gas molecules or with the walls happen, no energy is lost as heat or due to friction or as sound. The total energy contained by all the gas molecules in the container will remain constant. No energy is lost in the collision process. And it also means that there is no other force of interaction between the molecules except when they collide with each other. So there is no force of attraction or repulsion, there is no gravitational force. Okay, all these are the assumptions. So these are to simplify the model. Okay, so usually we can neglect gravity for molecules in a box if we consider that the molecules are so small that they hardly have any weight, like that. Okay, but in a real gas, gravity does have an effect, and that's why a balloon filled with air will weigh more than an empty balloon, because there is the force of gravity acting on the gas molecules, resulting in a net weight of the gas balloons. Okay, then the fourth assumption is that the temperature of the gas molecules is directly proportional to the average kinetic energy of the gas molecules. Now this assumption you have to understand very carefully what it means. See, and this assumption is true only for monoatomic gas molecules. That is, see, this average kinetic energy, by that, for our derivation, we are going to consider that it is just half mv square, where v is the average velocity of a gas molecule and m is the mass of that molecule. Okay, so half mv square will give the kinetic energy of that molecule. Now if we keep increasing its temperature by providing heat energy, whatever heat energy we provide, it gets absorbed by the molecule and gets converted into a greater velocity. That is, the heat energy gets converted to kinetic energy of the molecules, translational kinetic energy of the molecules. So this is true only for monoatomic molecules, because they have only these 3 degrees of freedom. That is, they can move along x-axis, y-axis, z-axis. But if you have diatomic molecules or more than two atoms, molecules with more than two atoms, then they have extra degrees of freedom. They can rotate around an axis, they can vibrate. So then the heat energy which we supply will no longer be used up to increase the translational kinetic energy. Instead, it will be used up to rotate the molecule, vibrate the molecule. So those kind of uses of energy will not appear as temperature increase. Okay, so we'll see why it is like that, why temperature is defined as just an increase in translational kinetic energy and not vibrational or rotational. Okay, we'll do that next. So then what are we going to derive in this lecture? We are going to derive this expression for pressure, that pressure is equal to n is the number of moles of gas, m is the mass of a molecule of gas, na is Avogadro number, u square bar is mean of the squares of the velocities of all the gas molecules in the box, and v is the volume of the box. So basically this is a relation between pressure and the average velocity of the molecules. And after deriving this relation for pressure as a function of velocity. So pressure is the macroscopic quantity, u the velocity is the microscopic quantity. We will use this to prove that PV by N is proportional to temperature. Remember, the ideal gas law is PV is equal to nRT. So from that we can get PV by N is proportional to temperature T. So R will be the proportionality constant. So once we derive this expression for pressure, if we can rearrange the terms to come appear in this form using our assumptions of kinetic theory, kinetic molecular theory, then we can say that we have proved the ideal gas law. So that is the next thing we'll do. Once we do that, we will derive an expression for the root mean square velocity by using these two formulae. Then we will do two IIT JEE problems. Okay.